is 305. Diocletian, the greatest Roman emperor in living memory, has just retired, along with his colleague Maximian. The burden of leadership now rests on new shoulders. In the west, Constantius Chlorus rules as the Augustus, with Valerius Severus as his Caesar. And in the east, Galerius rules as the Augustus, with Maximinus Daya as his Caesar. Constantius and Galerius have both served for over a decade as junior emperors and are more than ready for the task of senior leadership. The empire is at peace, its economy is recovering, and things are looking up. However, there were already issues with the succession. This round had been heavily influenced by Galerius, who had secured the appointments of both Caesars through his influence with Diocletian. His influence had allowed him to cut out two ambitious young men with real claims to leadership. The first was Maxentius, the son of Maximian. The second was the son of Constantius, a man you may have heard of. His name was Constantine. The first major upheaval came just a year after Diocletian and Maximian's abdications. Constantius Chlorus, the Augustus of the West, was on campaign with his son Constantine in Britain when he suddenly dropped dead in July of 306. What was the plan now? Was Severus supposed to be Augustus? He seemed to think so, declaring himself the new Augustus of the West. However, things got complicated immediately. Constantine's army in Britain decided to declare his son Constantine as both Caesar and Augustus. This was not part of the succession plan at all, and it immediately made Constantine a usurper in command of much of the Western Roman army. Luckily, the situation was quickly resolved by negotiations between Galerius and Constantine. The young emperor agreed to accept a position as Caesar in exchange for relinquishing his claims to Augustus. However, things were further complicated by a brewing situation in Rome. Reports of unpopular policies were stirring discontent in the city when the Praetorian Guard approached Maxentius and offered him the position of emperor in late 306. He accepted. Now Rome had five emperors. While Constantine was recognized as part of the Tetrarchy, Maxentius was an entirely unsanctioned usurper in Rome. He had to be put down for the sake of the system. In early 307, Valerius Severus marched down into Italy with several legions from Milan to put down the usurper and preserve the Tetrarchy. Maximian barely had a few thousand soldiers in his army. How hard could it be? Very hard, apparently. Much of Severus' army was made up with soldiers and officers who had made their lives and careers serving under Maximian. When they approached Rome, which was controlled by their former general's son, most of them defected to his side, forcing Severus to retreat behind the walls of Ravenna. Maxentius offered to spare his life in exchange for surrender, which Severus accepted. While securing his position in Italy, Maxentius called upon his father once again. Maximian had never been fully content in retirement and jumped at the chance to regain political relevance. The two ruled as joint emperors in Italy, unrecognized by the senior tetrarch Galerius. In mid-307, Galerius mustered his armies and attacked Italy with the aim of finally securing the tetrarchy's succession. However, his campaign was met with the same issues that had plagued Severus. Many of his troops harbored other loyalties and began defecting, forcing Galerius to retreat. Maxentius and Maximian were now secure in their positions as emperors in Italy and Africa, while Constantine, still technically Caesar, ruled in Gaul and Britain. Maximian and Maxentius worked on building their relations with Constantine, who was now the other power player in the West. Maximian, now technically the most senior member of the Tetrarchy, declared Constantine Augustus. Barely 3 years had passed between Diocletian's abdication and the absolute mess that Rome found itself in 308. Everyone agreed that the old emperor's advice was necessary to put the pieces back together. Diocletian was temporarily called out of retirement. Maximian, Galerius, and Diocletian all met at Carnuntum for a conference of the old Tetrarchs in mid-308. During this conference, Diocletian urged Maximian to give up his poisonous dream of everlasting power and prominence. By the end of it all, Galerius had decided to declare a man named Licinius as Augustus of the West, leaving Constantine as a Caesar. The conference dispersed with hopes high in the air. it would be the last time the three would see each other. Reportedly, at some point during the conference, Maximian pleaded for Diocletian to come back and take power again. Upon hearing this, he just shook his head and said, "If you could see the cabbages I'm growing, you would not think twice about retirement either." After receiving that pep talk from Diocletian, Maximian immediately decided to do something really dumb. He assembled officers in a forum in Rome and tried to take control from his son. To his surprise, the soldiers stayed with his son, and he was forced to flee to Gaul, taking refuge with Constantine. The son of Constantius was happy to accept a great man like Maximian, even if he was presently making a fool of himself. To add a bit more complication, the African provinces, not including Egypt, broke away from Maxentius' rule under a usurper named Domitius Alexander. This cut the grain supply to Italy, which was already limited without Egypt. By this point, the Tetrarchy was in shambles. Technically, Galerius and Maximinus Daya ruled in the east as Augustus and Caesar, with Licinius and Constantine in the west. But in practice, Licinius controlled no territory in the actual Western Empire. He was cut off by Maxentius in Italy, and Domitius controlled the crucial province of Africa. Maximian, who was under the protection of Constantine, just couldn't stop scheming. He was caught trying to orchestrate Constantine's overthrow in 309. Instead of executing him, Constantine offered him the dignified option of killing himself, which Maximian took. A sad end for a man who was once Diocletian's right-hand man and a competent ruler in his own right. In 309, six emperors ruled a tenuous situation. Previous political convention had already gone out the window. The Tetrarchy was stretched to its limits. Galerius, the senior Augustus, had been scheming and manipulating the members and structures of the Tetrarchy for over a decade to suit his interests. It had all led to the Tetrarchy's utter failure. He finally dropped dead in 311. No one really missed him. His death marked the end of the Tetrarchy's first generation. Entirely new blood would have to forge new paths through Rome's complex politics. Also with his death came the end of Christian persecutions in the Roman Empire. Galerius had been one of the most fervent enemies of Christianity, and as it would turn out, one of the last. Also departing the stage in 311 was an old friend of ours, Diocletian. I said in my last episode that he died peacefully. I gotta tell you, that might not be true. He had a lot to be sad about. His entire political system had basically fallen apart, his life's work had been ruined by incompetent successors, and his best friend had gotten himself killed. Some speculate that Diocletian died by suicide in December of 311. In the east, affairs were quickly settled after a war between Maximinus Daya and Licinius. After the settlements, Maximinus became the senior Augustus and controlled the whole empire east of the Bosporus, while Licinius was left with just the Balkan provinces. In the west, war was brewing between Maxentius and Constantine. Their rivalry had intensified when Constantine had forced Maxentius' father to commit suicide, and both sides began preparing for war in 311. For the purposes of this war, the Christians became an important interest group to court. Maxentius tried to win them over to his side, but only had limited success. Constantine was also thinking about how to ally himself with the Christians, perhaps not just for short-term political gain, but for the sake of his legacy. The decisive confrontation came in 312. Constantine decided that it was his turn to try and unseat the usurper, marching over the Alps from Gaul with an army of 40,000 soldiers. Maxentius' armies were waiting for him. Constantine won two decisive victories in northern Italy, succeeding in killing Maxentius' Praetorian prefect in one of them. Maxentius withdrew his forces back to the city of Rome, counting on his ample supplies of grain which he had secured from retaking Africa, and trusting the mighty Aurelian walls to protect him from Constantine's army. As Constantine approached the city, he prepared for a long siege. However, to his surprise, Maxentius left the walls of the city and positioned his soldiers with their backs to the Tiber River. It seemed that he wanted a confrontation by the Milvian Bridge. Constantine, happy to oblige, camped his troops across from Maxentius' position. The night before the battle, Constantine received a vision of a cross in the sky. It was accompanied by words that said, "In this sign, you shall conquer." He made haste, ordering his soldiers to paint the symbol of the Cairo, a symbol associated with Christianity at the time, on their shields. That night, he slept well, preparing for a great victory. Many believe this is the moment that Constantine began fighting in the name of the Christian God. In the morning, the two armies formed up for battle and began the fighting. Immediately, the weakness of Maxentius' position was made obvious. With their backs to the river, they were unable to maneuver and reform their ranks. Constantine applied pressure methodically, exploiting weaknesses and collapsing Maxentius' ranks. Before long, they were fleeing across the bridge, and Constantine was victorious. Maxentius died in the fighting, leaving Constantine as the sole emperor in the West. For the first time in history, a prince had won a great victory with the help of God, and the Tetrarchy was dead. Tweaking off that 2CB, huh? Is he gonna make it TBD, huh? Thought I was gonna run DMC, huh? I done died and lived again on DMT, huh? See, this the type of high that won't come down. This the type of high that get you gunned down. Easy trolling OD, huh? Turn TMZ to smack DVD, huh?